considered to be imposed, and then NPAs are considered to be increased because of the effect on industrial activities and other service sector as well. So when it comes to insurance sector on a good side has seen a very good implication because of the surge in the number of health insurance that has been brought during the COVID period. And also the number of claims that have been made has also increased, and as well as the settlement time, that the turnover time, that has also considerably reduced. So in this way, I think there are good chances, opportunities of improvement for banking and insurance sector.
Okay, so Bindu, do you have any official data showing that like number of candidates who is getting for insurance and all is increasing? Do you have any official data?
Yes, sir. Sir, the economic survey has shown about the under-penetration of insurance, sir. Sir, but as far as the IRDAI report, I'm not very sure of the data, but the general statement is that the number of claims that have been made has increased, and the LIC, as the largest life insurance, has increased the number of settlement of claim as well. It has been brought by LIC through its financial report.
Okay, so do you think moratorium is impacting banking sector in a negative way? Don't you think like you know banking is just getting you time like to pay your like you know due or loan like and interest is getting charged accordingly. Okay, so don't you think like it's not negative? It's like banking sectors are getting benefited from this moratorium.
Sir, I consider your statement, sir. But on another side, the cash inflow that comes into the banking sector for meeting its working capital requirement becomes halted, and the investment commitments that the bank have already taken into place, that has to be met because of the retrieval of the claims, retrieval of the loans that has been given. So in that case, when the moratorium is imposed, so it brings in a halt to the cash inflow for the banking sector.
So that is the present scenario, but what about in future? Of course, the segments are getting benefited.
Yes, sir. So in future, I think I hold a positive connotation with respect to the banking sector because RBI has been quite proactive to ensure that the MSMEs, who contribute larger sector of the banking lendings, they have been given credit guarantee schemes have been given to them, and 20,000 crore of liquidity support has also been introduced by RBI. In that way, I would say that the liquidity with respect to the working capital, which I mentioned before, will be revived because of the support that will be given by RBI in the future endeavors.
Okay, so coming to MSME segment, okay, so do you think like a budget allotted for MSMEs, okay, so is it getting distributed properly?
Yes, sir. So the most of the budget allocation that happens for the MSME, it mainly happens with a digital platform. Though we say that the plans are quite promising in the results, the concern is with respect to whether the MSME are digitally empowered to reap the benefits of all the banking, all the budget schemes that have been that has been given to them. So for example, the production linked incentive schemes, be it for that matter, sir. So they have to file the annual turnovers on the portal. So in that case, if they're not digitally empowered, they'll not be able to reap the benefit. And also the awareness among the MSMEs about the schemes that have been given by the government, that is also a concern in ensuring that the schemes reaches the MSMEs.
Okay, so Bindu, let's assume that you are the deputy collector.
Yes, sir.
So in present pandemic scenario, you are the deputy collector of any district. Okay,
Yes, sir.
so you can see like good number of cases are going day by day. Okay, so there are a lot of problems people are facing. Okay, so what are the steps you will be taking so that like you know we can administer in a better way, we can help people, okay, we can help life, okay, so what are you know challenges or what are the changes you would like to do in the system, present system?
Yes, sir. So firstly, I would utilize the lower constabulary of the policing in ensuring the COVID appropriate behavior is being followed by the people, and ensure that there's penalty rightly imposed to those not abiding it. So that is the behavioral approach. That's the first behavioral approach I'll be taking into consideration. Second is ensuring that there is equitable distribution of vaccination and ensuring and prioritizing the second dose for those who have taken the first dose. So that is on the vaccination basis. And thirdly, in order to ensure that the migrant workers or the informal sector are not completely hit by the COVID-19 pandemic, ensuring that the food distribution that happens, be it in Karnataka, the Indira canteen, that model would be undertaken to ensure that the basic amenities reaches the poorest of the poor. In that way, I would take a multimodal approach to ensure that the pandemic is under control and it doesn't affect the poorest of the poor.
Okay, very good. Okay, so I can say like your one of hobbies is mono acting.
Yes.
Okay, so you even have won some awards also in mono acting, national level award. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So could you please tell me a bit more on to that?
Yes, so mono acting is one form of the theater or plays that we do. Mono acting, it includes only one actor who plays multiple roles, or it might be just one role as well. So it is considerably of lesser duration compared to a full-fledged stage play. And it lies for about 5 to 10 minutes with respect to one character playing, and with respect to the script writing and directing. It can be the there can be another director doing it, or the actor himself can be a director script writer. So it's mainly a single person doing multimodal multiple roles here.
Okay, so how did you develop this hobby? Like, from where you got motivated in mono acting?
Yes, sir. Sir, this one, this hobby of mine, I eventually developed it when I was in my 11th and 12th. So there was a competition called mono acting, but I didn't know there was a team for theater. So I thought if I have to participate individually, so mono acting was a platform. So there I wanted to participate. So in that way, I established my trait of acting in that competition, and eventually I got opportunities, and from there I even joined a full-fledged theater team as well.
Okay, so I assume that you are the deputy collector, and how will you take advantage or take help of this mono acting in your administration?
Yes, sir. Firstly, the mono acting has taught me better and best way to communicate and develop my emotional intelligence along with my social skills as well. So in that case, at the negotiating bench or discussing with the public at large, I think my mono acting skills will help me in better persuading the public into following the right direction or moving into the right way. And also, sir, I would say with respect to working with teams, theater has helped me to be one among the team, heed to the needs and wants of all the members of the team. In that way, as a team, I can lead the team well by understanding the needs and wants of them.
Okay. Okay. So one more thing, challenge that basically we can observe nowadays. The challenge is people, many places like in remote areas, people are not interested to take vaccine. Okay. So that is one challenge, government or even system is going to provide vaccine, but people are not ready to get that. Okay. And second challenge is that schools, colleges and all study. Okay. So that is also getting impacted a lot. Okay. If people will not get vaccinated, system will not be in proper position. Okay. So everything will be in problem. Okay. So how, what is your suggestion basically, if people are not taking vaccine, so how you will be managing that? Okay. And second, what should be your suggestions with respect to schools, colleges and all, because at the end, our future, people who are going to be leaders in future, their knowledge is not getting into correct direction. Okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, with respect to vaccination, sir, the rising number of vaccine hesitancy that has been prevailing among the public. First is to ensure if it is in a rural area, it is worthwhile to talk to the influential people there or the major stakeholders in the villages to ensure that they communicate to their people and ensure that the vaccine is a means to curtail the transmission, and hence the vaccine has to be taken. So that way the confidence has to be built for taking vaccination. And as well, if it is in an urban scenario, sir, the personalities like in the entertainment arenas, or we as a representatives of the public and the political representative, they must themselves first take the vaccine and ensure that it has no side effects, and it is guaranteed that it can help us in reducing the transmission of COVID. So in this way, vaccine hesitancy in rural and urban areas can be reduced. And with respect to the education that has been majorly impacted because of COVID-19, sir. So in that case, though government has been quite proactive by bringing in e-Vidya scheme to ensure that the education is equitably available to everyone. And also, in addition to that, sir, the well-established network of radio and the Doordarshan, they have to be utilized to reach the lowest of the lowest level, because they have the stronger penetration than the digitalization. So maybe a slot of 1 hour or 3 hours per day has to be allotted for educational channels and under Doordarshan and radio, so that the educational gap that we're seeing during COVID, that can be bridged. And such equitable education that has been highly at risk can be reduced.
Okay, so I have one more question. So but why people will obey you that they should take vaccine? Okay, because because they think vaccine is not a positive thing in rural area. I'm talking about rural areas. Okay, they're strictly telling that we are not interested for getting vaccinated. Okay, so why they will obey you?
So, sir, in order because of the trust deficit they have with we as a bureaucratic system, that is the reason that I mentioned of communicating through the influential people among the rural areas. Because when they become the influencer, they have a trust established trust factor which they can rely on than relying on us. And hence we choose these intermediaries to get the vaccination rates higher in rural areas.
Okay, so thank you, Bindu, very much. Okay, so I'd like to request to Ankush sir. So please go ahead with asking some questions, followed by Sankat Mochan sir, Bhagav Ram sir, and Suman sir. Okay. So Ankush sir, please.
Yes, thank you so much, Amrit sir. Hello, Bindu.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. How are you?
Sir, I'm fine, sir. Thank you.
Hey, great. Okay, so I have seen your DAF, and I can see that you have had the public administration as your optional subject.
Yes, sir.
Any particular liking towards public administration, or that is usual trend by the civil services aspirants to score more marks in optional so as to get good rank? What was your choice, the interest or the scoring?
Sir, I think it's interest, sir, this, because those many might say that the scoring, because that is a trend, but my inclination was because of the subject and how it will help me in after joining the service as well, because of the diverse subjects that are involved, be it the rural district or the urban administration that is involved, and giving a international and Indian perspective of public administration. So that quite drew me to the sub towards the subject.
Okay, but have you had any activities done before, or maybe have you been doing any kind of activities that relate to typical public administration sort of issues in your personal life? Have you been part of some sort of activities?
Sir, I was a member of Oratory Club when I was in my undergraduation. So that involved me managing a certain number of people under me. So it had certain administrative activities that involved, because we organized a lot of events, and that had a direct connection with the society as well, because we had an event called Ekta, which involved a skilling program for people from underprivileged section. So that in that way, I think that I had a connection with public administration.
Okay, but that is like more towards the management. Okay, yes, when it comes to the public administration, obviously you have gone through both the subject matters like the paper one and paper two in public administration. When you actually have a liking towards public administration, it's not the management that you like, it's the public interest that you like.
Yes,
I mean, I'm asking you from that perspective, have you done any kind of activities in your personal circle or personal life which contributed towards the society?
Sir, I might not have done anything monetarily because I don't have a source of income. But as an individual, I have strived to be a very good citizen, sir. So I've always obeyed the rules and the public order. I don't dump waste on the street. And during COVID pandemic, I've been abiding to the COVID appropriate behavior. So as an individual, I've been quite contributing towards the society.
Okay. Good. Keep it up. If you see the definition of public administration or maybe definition of good governance, there are 8 parameters that are necessarily, that should be necessarily the part of the administration. Can you please name, few of them, what would contribute towards a good governance?
Yes, sir. So in that case, I would take the wordings of World Bank that has given the 8 pillars of good governance. In that way, first is the consensus, participative, accountability, transparency. Sir, right now I'm able to, rule of law. I'm able to remember these points right now.
Okay, that's fine. I just want you to prioritize them. The most important up to the lesser important. What would you consider the most important in being a good governance?
Transparency, sir.
Okay. If there is transparency but there is no participation, what would you do in that case?
True, sir.
Because participation is one of the important contributions towards good governance, right?
Yes, sir.
If transparency is there and there is no participation from the public, what would you do in that case? How would you consider that as a good governance?
Yes, sir. So in that way, I would say all these values of good governance are very interconnected. Losing one in the way would actually not lead us to the end output. So in that way, they have to move together in order to ensure good governance.
Okay. So what's your idea about the PM CARES Fund, about transparency?
Sir, indeed, PM CARES Fund needs transparency. It has to be brought under RTI because it is the money that has been funded from the public itself, be it individual or a well-established organization. So in that way, it very well needs to be brought under RTI and transparency needs to be upheld in PM CARES Fund.
Okay. So do you think that this is not a good governance?
Sir, I would say it has to move towards a pathway of good governance. Firstly, it has been established for a social cause of funding the health crisis. So that is a good step, and it has been utilized for various health related activities. But bringing in transparency by disclosing the information is also another need for good governance. So it has to abide by that law as well.
Okay. Coming again to the governance part, in this recent pandemic, you have seen that there have been many critics who have been observing that the cooperative federalism should have been the core of handling the pandemic situation. How do you see this cooperative federalism and the need of cooperative federalism in this current pandemic situation?
Yes, sir. In that way, first I would say the health sector, health as a item in the federal list, in the 7th schedule, lies in the state list. So in that case, there's a lot of blame game that happens when it comes to handling the crisis itself by state or the central government for that matter. So in that way, the cooperative federalism becomes very efficient because we have seen the High Court of Karnataka has asked the state government for to abide by the advisories given by the central government. So it has not abided because of the conflict, the ill coordination between state and the central government. If there was a smooth cooperative federalism upheld, there would have been an equitable distribution of vaccination, equitable distribution of oxygen and the ventilators. In that way, the health crisis would have been handled even more better than it is handled now.
So is this a good governance or what? Define it in terms of good governance.
the present situation of cooperative
Yeah, of
federalism, sir?
course. Yes.
So the present cooperative federalism that we're seeing needs to be tweaked, and it has to be streamlined, sir, because when it comes to handling crisis like COVID-19, it's not about state or the central government, it's about the whole India as well, because one or the other state failing becomes a failure of India. So in that way, it has to be streamlined. The state governments have to keep aside the political views and abide by the central government guidelines with respect to handling the crisis. In that way, it has to be abided, and right now it is not within the framework of good governance.
Okay. if you see, obviously, India is a very gigantic country geographically and even, you know, the demography wise.
Yes,
Panchayati Raj institutions or local self-government is one of the most important tools that we can use, you know, to handle the pandemic in a way to have a good governance, right? Yes. But if you look at the third tier of our government, that is the Panchayati Raj institutions, the motive of having the third route to handle the situation at the grassroots level, don't you think that the Panchayati Raj institutions or typically the Panchayat elections and all that sort has only become a political institution rather than, you know, being an effective, you know, form of government or handling the situation at the local governments?
Yes, sir. Sir, the mere institutionalizing the PRIs or the urban local bodies was a talk way back in 1990s. But I think the situation is quite transitionary, and it is evolving to be an empowered institute right now. Because I would take the example of the COVID-19 itself, where we saw the model of Bilwara model, be it the Dharavi slum model, which showed that the district administration or be it the panchayats in handling the rural transmission rate during the first wave, they were quite effective, and that showed how PRIs and ULBs can be a instrument of decentralization or handling any pandemics in future. So there are evidences that PRIs and ULBs are being empowered, but there needs to be a more functionaries and funding that has to be devolved to them, and the state governments especially they have to empower themselves to bring in order to devolve the powers to the PRIs and the ULBs.
Okay. Last year, March around, the government of India announced a lockdown, like all of a sudden.
Yes.
Okay. And this time, even the high courts and even the Supreme Court had, you know, given a suggestion to the central government, the union government, saying that a lockdown, national lockdown, may be looked into. But still, the government of India is yet to announce any sort of lockdown. What do you think? The government has learned something from the previous lockdown, or government is strategizing something else this time?
Yes, sir. So I think the lesson has been quite clear this time, because the second wave is very unique when compared to the first wave. The first wave was very unique and novel for us. We were not ready to handle it. Hence, lockdown became a need of the hour. But the second wave has been quite regionalized, and it has been more clustered up. There's been more clustered with respect to the transmission rate. In that way, I think a regional-based lockdown or restriction is a need of the hour, and that has been followed. And when it comes to national lockdown, that is not a need right now, because most of the northeastern states, be it some of the western and the eastern states, they're not highly affected because of the second wave. In that way, if we impose a national lockdown, it would drastically bring down the economic activities of these states, and it would not reap benefits that actually is expected from them.
Okay. Right. I would like to take you to the little, you know, aspect of economy. As you have done your BCom, and you know, you have your specialization in insurance and, you know, sort of that part. In case of Indian economy, if you see, you know, since the 1947 till now, India has been evolving, you know, through its economy a lot. And past 1990s, the BOP crisis, India has, you know, boosted its economy to a greater extent. But if you talk in terms of the, you know, primary sector, secondary sector, and the tertiary sector is giving a lot of contribution to our GDP, right? The secondary sector is not that yet developed in India, which the government of India is, all, of course, looking into it. Do you think that government of India should have adopted made in India approach rather than make in India? Do you think, is there any difference between the two concepts?
Yes, sir. Sir, with my limited knowledge, the make in India refers to the complete manufacturing from the start, including the raw materials. Made in India has a little narrower approach of integrating into the global chain with respect to the various other cycles of manufacturing. Because I think that is the difference, sir. I'm not that aware. I will worry on that.
What is the China's model? What is China's model? Made in China or make in China?
Sir, if I have to take a answer, I think it is more of make in China. Made in China, sir.
Made in China. So what's the difference? I mean, you can take a guideline from them. I mean, you can see, if you see the industrial part of China, China is considered as the global hub for manufacturing. Right? Yes. Now tell me, considering India's position in case of secondary sector, could we have adopted made in India instead of make in India? I'm just giving you hints.
Yes, sir. So understood, sir. I think this is with respect to integrating the Make in India with Assemble in India project, where we try to be a country where we provide cheap labors and cheap capitals. So ensuring that the countries where the real manufacturing happens, they come to India for the assembling of the products, and hence it gets the tag of Made in India and gives the exporting opportunities to India.
Okay, do you think, you know, all the products that, you know, mentioned made in China are all only assembled in China and, you know, manufactured somewhere else?
Sir, I think it is
manufactured, assembled and everything done, just exported from there, you know, in a ready piece.
So I think it is a part of the global value chain where China is the end chain of the global value, and from there it goes to the end customers.
Okay. Let's talk about the budget, the aspect of budget. If you see, in case of budgeting, particularly in case of Indian budget, there is a lot of or a bigger chunk goes towards the subsidies. Okay, if you see, the Indian democracy is a socialistic democracy. Right. So when the bigger chunk of the revenues that the government of India gets goes towards subsidies, do you think that subsidies are like what the critics say, that subsidies actually eat a lot of developmental projects? Do you agree with the critics? Do you think that the subsidies should not be given so much so that the government of India gives, and the amount that we invest in subsidies should be diverted to the developmental project?
Sir, I indeed agree with the export view, because giving subsidies might in a short term, it might give us the benefit of giving good prices to the agriculture, the farmers. But in a long term, it's not impacting the actual causes for the non-recovery of prices in the agriculture or the problems that is actually faced in agricultural sector. Because, sir?
Subsidies are not only about farming. Understand that. Even you, in case of LPG, you are getting subsidy. Petroleum, you are getting subsidy. The corporate subsidies are there. MSMEs are getting subsidies. Almost all the sectors which are in developmental mode will get subsidies. So talking that terms, not just the farmers or, you know, agricultural point of view.
Yes, sir. Sir, the subsidies that are allotted for the LPGs that are empowering women, the subsidies that are given for the electricity to the poor, so they are something that are empowering the poor and ensuring that they have a basic standard of living. So they are something that are actually reducing the out-of-pocket expenditure among them. So that needs to be continued. So that way, subsidies have been a tool for development. When it comes to the subsidies, the price subsidies, or the subsidies given for the chemical fertilizers, so they might reap benefits in the short term, but not in the long term. So in the long term, they have a counterproductive effects on the agriculture, or be it for the industrial activities as well. So they have to cut down, and they have to be invested for public investment in agriculture, because in agriculture, most of them are private investment than the public investment that has been brought in. And it was shown in the economic survey of 2019 and 20 last year as well.
Okay. Right. Obviously, Government of India announces different sort of schemes all the time. There are types of schemes such as central sector schemes, central schemes, centrally sponsored schemes. There are different funds called as funds of funds. What are these? Are these part of the subsidies, or Government of India announces a separate sort of fund, for the development of these schemes or undertaking all these schemes?
Sir, some of them are related to subsidies. For example, if a scheme is announced, under that a fund has to be allocated, because a subsidy is something that is being paid by the government. So the fund that is being given under the scheme goes for the subsidies, if it is a subsidy related scheme, in that way.
Right. Recently, there was a concept called compulsory licensing in the news.
Yes.
Do you have any idea what that is?
Yes, sir.
What is it?
So it is related to intellectual property right, where patent that has been given, IP that is given for certain product or the process, if it is of in public need for based on the situation, they will be given to the private the third player or the other players in the market to be produced without the permission taken by the patent holder.
Without the permission.
So they will be given the compensation, but they are for using the patent and bringing the production. But even though they go against it, it will be licensed for the betterment of the better need of the public.
Because there is a concept called as license in it. So if it's a license, it's an agreement between the, obviously the patentee and the one who wants to utilize the patent. So it's an agreement between the two, right?
Yes, so the patent will be taken by the government, and the government will enter into the agreement with the private players.
Not the patentee.
So the patentee, I think, will be compensated for taking over the patent by the government, sir.
Okay, why do you think this is in news?
So because of the waiver that has been asked in the global platform WTO for the COVID vaccines.
Okay, but then there is no compulsory licensing concept in US. In WTO, there is no concept of compulsory licensing as that in Indian patent law.
Yes, sir.
We have a dedicated section in Indian patent law for compulsory licensing.
Yes, sir.
But in case of US, the one you are talking about, there is a patent waiver for manufacturing. So What is the difference between these two concepts?
Yes, sir. So in patent waiver, the thing is, the formula that is being patented, the technology transfer will not happen, but the private players will be given the right to patent.
Yes.
Irrespective of.
Exactly. What is the doctrine behind this compulsory licensing?
What is
the doctrine behind the compulsory licensing? Why one should have a compulsory licensing?
Sir, sometimes the holder of the patent might lead to monopoly with respect to the production of such a product, and then it might lead to surge in the prices as well. So when it becomes, if the public is not able to reap the benefits or able to access the use of such patent because of high prices, then the compulsory license comes in and they bring down the prices through generic manufacturing.
Okay. But if you are a researcher, the patentee who has invented the drug, but we'll talk in terms of drug typically, obviously you will have spent billions of dollars in the research. Why do you want, to share the core formula with the market who has not invested anything in that? And you have invested billions of dollars. So isn't that injustice to the patentee?
So in one way, yes, it does bring down the innovation in invention. But this compulsory licensing is used only in rarest of the rarest cases, and it has been used only once till now. So in that way, when the public need surpasses the invention and other needs, I think compulsory licensing needs to be done, and it should be a last resort tool that we use.
Okay, Bindu, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Over to you, Sankat Mittal, sir.
Sankat Mochan, sir, I think you are on mute.
Good afternoon, Bindu. Can you hear me?
Ah, sir, yes, sir.
You have a beautiful smile.
Thank you so much, sir.
You've been speaking for quite some time now. Would you want to have some water or something?
No, sir, thank you so much.
All right. Been listening to all your the entire conversation that you've had thus far with Amresh sir and then Ankush sir. I will want to begin with your hometown. I mean, with your city rather, Bengaluru. So, were you born and brought up in Bengaluru, Bindu?
Yes, sir. I was born and raised in Bangalore.
Okay, so you're a city girl.
Yes, sir.
All right. So Bangalore has had, I mean, historically, Bangalore had a lot of lakes. They seem to have disappeared. Why? Could you throw some light over that?
Yes, sir. So it's unfortunate that once called as land of lakes, Bengaluru, now we see very few lakes that are surviving in Bengaluru. So Bangalore. So first and the foremost reason is the encroachment of the lakes that are happening because of the rising number of real estate agencies and real estate activities. In that way, the land has been more in demand, and hence these lakes have been dried, encroached upon, and is used for building and construction activities. Secondly, I would say it is because of the evolving climate change, and most of the lakes have dried up, and hence because of no further usage, they have been converted into commercial or residential places. I think these two reasons majorly have affected the decreasing number of lakes.
Bindu, do you not think that it's, I mean, lakes are of perennial use. The entire country is going through a water crisis. It is impossible that the lakes are not of use. You know, you would want to restore lakes and not get rid of them.
Yes, sir.
So lakes are, of course, they never run out of utility. They are always in use. So what do you think is the contribution of industrial effluents in the, you know, contamination of lake water, the pollution that is happening? And
Yes,
what
sir.
would you do if you were to manage the situation? What would you do to help matters in this regard?
Yes, sir. So thank you for adding the point that industrial increasing number of sewage water and the effluents from the industries, there have also been a reason for decreasing utility of the lakes over a time in Bengaluru. So they have played a major contribution, and we have been seeing the cases in reality as well. The foaming in the Belandur Lake and the Warthur Lake, that has been quite constant, and it has had a repercussion on the residents of the area, leading to respiratory and skin diseases as well. So the repercussion has been quite daring in real terms. So if given the power to ensure that the revival of the lakes happen, firstly, I would ensure that I have the count of number of lakes that are in the Beng in Bangalore, so that no further encroachment happens in future. Secondly, bringing in creating a buffer zone of 20 meters around the lakes, so that there is so that no commercial activities or any activities lead to any further polluting of the lakes, and regulating the industrial effluents, treating them before they have been discharged into the lakes, and ensuring that there is compulsory assessment happens annually, so that the lake doesn't lose its life before the end of its own time.
So that's Bindu as a bureaucrat talking, isn't it?
Yes.
Bindu as the leader of an
Yes,
institution
sir.
to
I've
revive lakes.
Yes, I wanted to add another point. So sorry, I forgot that while answering. So in preserving the lakes, I think community participation is also a very important step. So I would utilize the well-established network of civil society that too as vibrant as civil activism in Bangalore. So they play a major role. So they will be delegated with the power to invigilate and securitize the lakes so that so that activities from the industries or any influential parties don't lead to polluting the lakes more in the future.
Bindu, could you name some plant species that are capable of, decontaminating lake water?
Water hyacinth. Yes, sir. They are used in the purification of waters.
Have you heard of a species called Citronella?
No, sir. Citronella, no, sir. Thank you for the information, sir.
Could you tell me something about peroxyacetyl nitrate and its relationship to the pine tree?
Sorry, I couldn't get the question, sir.
Could you tell me something about peroxyacetyl nitrate, PAN, that is its abbreviated form, and its relationship to the pine tree, P-I-N-E, pine tree?
That's all right.
Basically, PAN is a secondary pollutant, and the pine tree is a natural, it naturally absorbs peroxyacetyl nitrate from the environment. Peroxyacetyl nitrate also leads to the creation of tropospheric ozone.
Ozone. Okay. Thank you so much for the information, sir.
Yeah. So that is about Bangalore. Let's talk something about the international affairs. The outgoing leader of Japan has been proposing to amend the constitution of Japan. Could you give me the background to that? What is the background? Why is he wanting to do that? And which is the particular part of the constitution he is running after?
Sir, I've not heard of it. I will read on it, sir. I'm not aware of that.
Okay. Japan is wanting to amend Article 9 of its constitution. Its constitution was not written by the Japanese people. It was imposed upon them by America after the Second World War, 1945. So they're a pacifist country, isn't it? So they want to kind of reorient their defense and make it an offensive army and not just a defensive army. The corona epidemic and Chinese diplomacy, could you correlate? What is wolf warrior diplomacy in China?
Wolf warrior diplomacy in China.
Yeah.
Sir, I have not heard of it, sir. So I'm not able to make a guess also. So I will.
Okay.
I'm not
able That's to... all right. Read about it. It's basically about, not empathizing with the epidemic internationally, also kind of adopting a very aggressive mode of diplomacy so far as the foregrounding of Chinese interests in the world is concerned. I mean, otherwise, Chinese diplomats were considered to be very placid, but they're wanting to kind of convert that placid attitude towards diplomacy and make it more aggressive. So basically, Wolf Warrior is a movie.
Yes, sir.
And so having taken cues from that, it's a right-wing kind of a movie. Taking cues from that movie, they have tried to reorient their diplomacy and they now call it Wolf Warrior Diplomacy. Okay. All right.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the information.
Management of COVID situation. What is the difference between medical oxygen and industrial oxygen?
Yes. Sir, the medical oxygen, the percentage of oxygen concentration that is needed is 91%. Whereas for industrial activities, the oxygen concentration is required almost about 98%. So the concentration of oxygen that is needed is the differing value.
So could you divert industrial oxygen to meet the crisis in oxygen supply in the healthcare sector?
Sir, ideally it seems to be right, but practically it becomes inefficient to transfer to transmit the industrial oxygen to the medical purposes, because the concentration differs and it can have ill effects on the patients as well.
All right. You were talking about the Bhilwara model to contain corona.
Yes, sir.
What would be the Bindu model of containing corona?
Yes, sir. So firstly would be, I believe that though simple, I think COVID appropriate behavior is the everlasting tool that we can always abide by. So I would ensure that the COVID appropriate behavior is utilized. And with my experience in COVID, sir, I've seen that lower constabulary can play a very good role in ensuring the COVID appropriate behavior, mainly in the public utilization of public transportation. And that was tested in the metros of the Bengaluru, where the constables were deployed inside the metros, and they invigilated while the passengers were traveling with respect to maintaining the social distancing, wearing the mask. So in that way, that would be the first mantra that I will be adopting. Second one is prioritizing the vaccination, prioritizing based on the risk and based on the availability. So in that way, ensuring that the vulnerables like the 45 plus and 60 above, they are vaccinated first, and also the second dose, who are waiting for the second dose, they are prioritized, and then we move on to the next age bracket. So the vaccination will be the second step I'll be looking forward for. And thirdly is the availability of the equipments to ensure that the treatment for those who are infected by COVID, that is being streamlined. In that case, the home quarantine has to be highly prioritized for those cases where, for most of the cases, because of the oxygen level in them. So based on the oxygen level, they have to, I would be suggesting more home quarantine and utilizing the civil societies and creating mother NGOs to supervise over their behaviors and their needs. And prioritize for the 10% of the population who need the ventilators and equipments. So there has to be a certain reservation that is done in every hospital, including the private hospital, for the ventilators and the oxygen concentrators for these 10% of the population who are having a high need of respiratory support.
Okay. All right. I'll take you to some other area now. Could you tell me the difference between tundra and taiga?
Sorry, sir?
Tundra and taiga. Geography? You must have read
this. Yes, sir. Geography. Yes, sir. Sir, when it comes to tundra region, I think it is the temperature. Temperature differences. I'm not able to recall the temperature, but one is the temperature differences and the vegetation, the tree, the types of trees that are found. In tundra, we mainly see the coverage of snow. In taiga region, we see the coniferous and the deciduous trees as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. You mentioned IPS as your second choice of service after the Indian Administrative Service.
Yes, sir.
Could you run a mile or 100 meters race?
So yes, sir. I am physically fit. I exercise on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
So I can.
What about those big spectacles that you've got?
Yes, sir. My vision, I have a problem with the vision, and I'm working towards that as well. I'm practicing eye yoga, and I'm also eating healthy. I don't know how well it is going to add on to that, but based on the other physical appearances or the fitness, based on that, I think I'm fit enough and I can run.
Okay, so you could chase a few thieves.
Yes, sir.
All right. You were talking about subsidy with Ankush, sir, and I want to know that what was the conclusion of your arguments? Do you mean to say that is subsidy the most efficient instrument of the delivery of welfare?
So subsidies need the need of subsidy depends on the situation or the cause that we're using it for. If we are using it for to meet a short-term needs, for example, recovery of prices or ensuring that the fertilizer or the raw materials are available at a reasonable price, so that can be made held in a shorter period. Whereas for the subsidy as a tool of development, by ensuring that the LPG gases are available, ensuring that the food subsidy that we give, ensuring that the out-of-pocket expenditure doesn't exceed. So that way, that needs to continue because of the level of poverty that we are facing. Yeah.
So does it not indicate the failure of institutions? I mean, if the institutions are, had the institutions been successful at delivering welfare, the state would not have to depend entirely upon subsidies to deliver welfare. I mean, welfare is the job of the institutions that run the country. Subsidy is just an instrument. Why is it that the subsidies have come to replace institutions?
Yes, sir.
Is that a cause of concern?
Sir, I would say the subsidy has become a tool for welfare now. It is run through the well-established institution itself. And the act of giving the subsidies is the recognition that the government has done about the level of poverty and the need of the people. So when the government is taking a step and giving the subsidies, it's basically solving the problem at the grassroots level, be it through food subsidies or be it through the LPG subsidy it is giving. Mm-hmm.
So you want to say that it is used to address a certain market failures, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
All right. You have also mentioned, like, sir, a number of questions have already been thrown at you regarding mono acting. However, I want to dig a little deeper. Have you ever explored Shakespeare? Does any character in Shakespeare lend itself or is amenable to mono acting? Could you throw some light over that?
Yes, sir. And yes, sir, I've heard through my peers about Mark Antony as a character by William Shakespeare, through William Shakespeare's literature, that has been used mainly for the monologues, that are basic monologues and mono acting. So in that way, I've established that Mark Antony becomes a very prominent character for mono acting.
So Mark Antony features in which play by Shakespeare?
Julius Caesar.
Julius Caesar. Any other character other than Mark Antony that you try to explore beyond your peers?
Sir, for my mono acting, I chose a character from the mythology, that is the Satyavan Savitri. So I chose that the conversation between Satyavan Savitri and Yama during the last sequence, the conversation that happens. So I took that as a piece and I enacted that. So that is the one that I got inspired. And then I took it up and I made a mono act through that.
How do you pronounce Yama? You just pronounced it as Yama.
Yes, sir. Yama. Yes, sir.
Is it not the anglicized pronunciation? What would the Hindi pronunciation be? It's a Hindi word, isn't it? Yama. Yama.
Yama. Okay. I was not aware of it, sir. Thank you.
I mean, see, that happens. I mean, that most of us do that. We always add an A towards at the end of the word, and that makes it more anglicized, but that kind of betrays the original version of the word Yama. Okay. So Mark Antony, I would suggest you explore Iago as well. Iago from Othello. You could explore Shylock, Merchant of Venice. All right. So these I would suggest.
Yes,
another question about caste consciousness. Is caste consciousness very much a part of the historical consciousness in the Dalit communities of India? Could you tell me something about the traditional activities of the Kuruba community in Karnataka?
Yes, sir. So the Kuruba community, we see the reference of Kuruba community from the Sangam literature, Kuruvars, where it is mentioned by the one of the Sangam literature, the Kuruvars, who means the people who are the rare animals. So Kurubas are the one who rear the sheep and look after the sheep. Basically, they're historically a shepherd, related to the occupation of shepherds.
What is transhumans?
Transhumans. I'm not aware of it, sir.
Nomadic tribes?
Nomadic tribes, yes, sir.
So the phenomena of tribal people moving from one geographical region to another according to the climate change is called transhumans.
So thank you for the information.
Okay,
sir.
Thank you. That is it, Bindu. I'll
thank
stop
you so
here.
Much,
I'll hand over to Bhargav, sir. Thank you a lot. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Hi, Bindu. How are you?
Sir, I'm good, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. I think your option is public administration, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can you explain the four pillars of public administration?
Four pillars of public administration?
Yeah.
So in general, you're asking about the pillars of public administration, sir?
Yeah. In general, you can explain.
Yes, sir. In general, the first pillar, I would say, is policy making. Second one is the policy implementation, the feedback, and the controlling.
Okay, you told me only three. I asked for
policy making, policy implementation, supervision, and controlling.
Okay. If I ask what are the five major pillars of public administration, what will be the fifth one, which we can correlate with the present scenario?
The decentralization.
Are you sure?
So that's what I'm considering based on the...
No, your option is public administration, right?
Yes, sir.
Especially in administrative theories and Indian administration, I think you had gone through this.
Yes, sir.
Right? Okay, fine. That is fifth one, especially in crisis, you can consider speed as the fifth.
Okay, sir.
Okay, that is why I am saying speed in present scenario, you can correlate with it.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you,
right.
sir. Thank you for the information.
Next one, can you explain the difference between public administration and management?
Yes, sir. So public administration is a government-led and government-owned institution, whereas management is more of a private stakeholders and private establishment. And public administration... it involves a service motive, whereas management has a profit motive.
That's it.
So right now I'm able to come up with two differences.
Right. Good. Next one. Yesterday, before 18 hours back, Karnataka has crossed regarding the COVID cases to the Maharashtra. So why it is happening? Though they had kept a lockdown in Karnataka, though the cases are going higher and higher by day basis. What are the major reasons? Can you explain?
Yes, sir. So firstly, sir, I think the number of vaccination has been brought, has drastically come down. And most of them who were supposed to get the second dosage as well, they're also missing the target line. So that is majorly causing for the increasing number of cases, that is the vaccination has decreased, so the transmission has also increased right now. And secondly, sir, the construction activities and the gig economy, that is the Ola and the aggregators, they have been let to function during the lockdown as well. So I think they have also contributed majorly for the increasing transmission.
Yeah, but you said that vaccination dosages was decreased all over India because lack of the supply.
Yes, sir.
But even though in Maharashtra, if you see the cases are coming down, at least the curve is going to be flat.
Yes, sir.
Why so? Though the density population in Maharashtra is more than Karnataka.
Yes, sir. Sir, I think one is the how well the administration has functioned in distribution of the equipments and the critical in equipments like the ventilators and oxygen. So in that case, I think Maharashtra was quite efficient in equitably distributing the resources. But in Karnataka, I think the number of deaths or number of cases have been increasing because of non-availability of the oxygen itself. Basically, I would quote the example of Chamrajnagar district, where 29 deaths in one day were reported because of non-availability of the oxygen and the critical equipments. So in that case, I think non-availability of the critical equipments have been majorly causing for the rising surges and the fatalities as well.
Good. Next one, what is black fungus and why the cases and black fungus cases are increasing in Karnataka?
Yes, sir. So black fungus is increasing majorly with people with comorbidities after recovering from COVID. Those with diabetic and other comorbidities, they have the increasing intake of steroids has been counterproductive to their own body, and it is leading to the black fungus status among the residents in Bangalore.
No, why the cases are increasing only in Karnataka? That's what my question is.
Sir, in that case, maybe because of the number of cases relating to people with comorbidities like diabetes are more in Bangalore, and the number of people taking steroids as a reaction towards COVID-19 is also more in Bangalore. So I think in that case, the reaction has been the black fungus.
How can you say that? Do you have any data?
Sir, I think based on the lifestyle of Bengaluru, the type 2 diabetes cases are more in Bengaluru. In that case, I would draw the analysis.
Right. Can you explain the dichotomy theory?
Dichotomy?
Dichotomy theory in public administration.
Yes, sir. So the dichotomy was introduced by the father of public administration, Woodrow Wilson. He provided for the separation of public administration, that is administrative, and the political administration. So in that case, there is no overlapping of work and there is no political interference in the civil and other public administration.
Can you differentiate between public administration and political science?
Yes, sir. So public administration gives theory about how a it gives the theory of how the services of the government reaches the public. It majorly focuses on policy making and policy implementation, whereas political science is more of giving theories of the political setup. It gives the theory of how the administrative or an institution that runs the public administration, it gives theories on that.
That's it. Sir, Suman, sir, I'm handing over to Suman. Please carry.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Bindu. All the best.
Thank you, sir. Sir, your mic is muted.
Sorry. Okay, Bindu. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
We've been speaking really long for now. I'll not keep you long in waiting now anymore further. But just a couple of quick questions. You know, a hot topic which I personally feel, you know, it's getting a lot of, you know, criticism and facing a lot of flack is the Central Vista project. Okay, let's come to there. Can you please help me understand why does India need a new parliament building?
Sir, I think it's more of a colonial legacy that we have seen, because of the designer was one from the British administration. So I think instead of carrying on the colonial legacy or the colonial architecture, we want to introduce our Indian touch or Indian administrative touch to the new parliament. So in that way, I think the motive has been driven. But at the need of the hour is not to have a new parliament, sir, because right now in the COVID-struck pandemic, the need of the hour is the health and the livelihood of the people. And I think the Central Vista project can be put on hold, and or the fund that has been allocated for that project can be diverted for ensuring the needs of the people during this health crisis can be met.
Okay, but do you think, Are you absolutely certain that only to remove that colonial legacy that we need a new parliament building? For example, what I mean to ask you is, let's consider, you know, the Rashtrapati Bhavan, which earlier used to be called as the Viceroy's Palace. Okay, so now it's we proudly say that it's the Rashtrapati Bhavan. So we are not building a new Rashtrapati Bhavan. Because if you talk from the colonial perspective of things, then we are not building a new Rashtrapati Bhavan. We are not completely demolishing the North Block or the South Block. You know, talking with respect to colonial legacy, then, you know, almost half, more than half of Delhi, which we call it Latians Delhi. So of that will be put to question or put to testament. So clearly the answer is definitely not to colonial legacy. Okay. But okay. Fine. Then the other thing that I wanted to ask is, what is Article 50 of the Constitution of India?
So Article 50 provides for separation of legislature from the executive.
Okay. So, but again, it's a directive principle of state policy, right? So do you think Indian government or the parliament or, you know, the legislatures have taken a step forward to bring into effect some thing which was provisioned in Article 50? Do you think they've done something? Because ultimately, when strictly speaking, Article 50 talks about separation of judicial powers or from the executive regarding the state services,
yes,
as in administrative services. So do you think that some steps have been taken?
Sir, I think... So I'll take a minute and think of it, sir.
Yes, yes, please.
Sir, though it is enshrined in Article 50, we have been following that the parliament procedures also, it is mentioned in Constitution also to not to bring in the judicial proceedings or the judgment given by the judiciary should not be discussed in Parliament. So it is given in the Constitution itself.
Discussion of judicial proceedings in the Parliament tantalizes or amounts to, you know, to keep independence of the judiciary.
Yes, sir.
But here, as you pointed out to Bhargav Ram, sir, when you're talking the concept about dichotomy of powers or dichotomy of distribution to essentially to avoid concentration of powers. So what is was envisaged that in state services earlier, the judicial powers were also vested on the executives, as in suppose who was a collector, he was also serving as a judge.
Yes, sir.
Okay. He was also serving in the capacity of a magistrate. So, but now, clearly, there is difference between a magistrate and there is a difference between a collector. There's a difference between a divisional judge or a subdivisional judge and a difference between, you know, a deputy secretary or, as a matter of fact, a deputy collector or anyone. So clearly, now we have separated. So can you just help me understand where this separation occurred? There was a specific enactment, you know, post which this thing got separated. That was the CRPC, the Criminal Procedure Code, which was in provision and which was brought into effect in 1973. That is the Criminal Procedure Code, which separated. So now you have a separate judicial magistrate rather from a collector. Earlier, whatever works was being done by a judicial magistrate, all that was vested in the district collector itself. So the executive was also serving as the judge. So
thank
to bring into effect, yes. But then my next question is coming from this, that, you know, you've heard, at least because you'll be into public administration, you would have heard a term called Indian Penal Code.
Yes, sir.
I heard about something, but now I informed you about something called CRPC, Criminal Procedure Code.
Yes, sir.
What is the difference between both of them?
Yes, sir. So the Indian Penal Code gives the guidelines, whereas Criminal Procedure Code provides the complete procedure of the execution of that Indian Penal Code.
Can you please elaborate a little further?
Sir, I have not.
For example, when it comes to public administration, the thing is, you said that, you know, when you're into mono acting, you need to articulate, you need to be able to communicate it to someone in the simplest of terms so that they'll be able to comprehend and understand. Okay. So from that perspective, if I'm a layman, can you please just help me differentiate between Indian Penal Code and Criminal Procedure Code?
Yes, sir. So I think they have the relation of the same as an act and the rules. The act provides for the provisions, whereas the rules provide the complete guidelines of who has the power, authority, functioning of certain bodies that are established. In that way, IPC provides for the guidelines or provides for the punishment or any such guidelines, whereas the CRPC provides for who has the authority, who is responsible, and the institution that is empowered to give the judgment. In that way, it provides the procedure, and whereas IPC provides for the statement.
So which should be older, like which would have logically come first, the IPC or the CRPC?
So logically, IPC should have come first, but we have the CRPC is quite older than the IPC.
No, don't make haste. The IPC is actually old. The IPC was, again,
Cowley,
stated in 1860 by Lord Macaulay. He was, again, the same guy who was vested, you know, with bringing in the English system of education into India. So it was he, which got it happened in 1860. And the CRPC came into effect in 1973.
Okay, so thank you for the information.
Yes. And coming to last information, again, you feel free to use monoacting, feel free to use simple terms, feel free to do it in whatever way you are wishing to tell me. But please, you know, okay, a lot of people in this panel have already attributed you to being a deputy collector or a collector of a district. I'll put you in the same chair as well. And with that thing in mind, can you please help me understand the very basic, I'm a person in your district who's willing to go and get vaccinated, but I have shown concerns that I just want to know what is the difference between Covishield and Covaxin. I've heard these two terms. I don't know what the difference is, but for my body, I want to be with the best. I want to have the best. I don't want to have any side effects and all. So please help me understand the difference between these two vaccines.
Yes, sir. Sir, we have two vaccines available. One is the COVID shield and the Covaxin. Covaxin is indigenously manufactured by Bharat Biotech, whereas COVID shield is something through the Serum Institute of India that is manufactured through the technology transfer from the AstraZeneca. How different they are is basically the modes through which they have been made. Covaxin is mRNA vaccine, and COVID shield is made through the common cold virus. It uses the common cold virus in an inactivated mode, so that the body, when the virus, when this vaccine is injected to the body identifies it, and the antibodies are developed, so that when a COVID as a virus gets injected to your body, the body has a well-developed immune system through the well-established antibodies because of the vaccine that you have taken, so that you don't become a means of transmission in further, and the severity of the infection also gets reduced. In that way, I think vaccine becomes a mode of reducer of the transmission. And for you being a sole member, the bread earner of the family, it becomes very important because of the mobility that you because of the travel that you do on a daily basis. In that case, I think vaccine becomes a need of the hour for you.
Okay, but as you rightly pointed out, you know, one has the common cold vaccine and one is mRNA vaccine. What is an mRNA vaccine?
mRNA vaccine is, we use the inactivated form of the COVID virus itself, which is inactivated, and they have been they're used to the mode of mRNA. We use a vector for the transmission, and then it is injected to your body. It doesn't have any certain infection. It just is a mode of developing antibodies in your body.
So from the two examples that I mentioned, which is an mRNA vaccine?
So Covaxin is a mRNA vaccine. COVID shield is developed with the common cold virus.
Okay. Okay, just a small edit there. Covaxin is actually the weakened coronavirus itself. It's the weakened coronavirus. So it's not an mRNA vaccine, Covaxin. Okay. It's a weakened coronavirus. And the other virus, when we are talking about Covishield, that uses a virus which is called Enola virus or something, which is from the body of a chimpanzee. Because, you know, somehow we are related to humans. Chimpanzees are related, close relatives of humans. So that vaccine, the external, a little bit of modification has been done to that vaccine, and hence Covishield is the vaccine. That one is the other modified vaccine. So when we're talking about strict terms, mRNA vaccine, it's ideally the vaccine which is made by Johnson & Johnson or Pfizer, which we are not administering in India right now.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the information.